Hey, crazies.
Once or twice, you might have heard someone say something like,
The fabric of the universe.
There's not really a fabric, though. It's just an analogy. It's meant to make space and time sound more tangible, like something that can be changed. But what if there was a fabric? How elastic would it be?
This episode was made possible by generous supporters on Patreon.
The interaction between space-time and matter is governed by Einstein's equation. It looks something like this, which can be a bit intimidating. Okay, it's a lot intimidating. But all this stuff is really just one thing, space-time curvature. This other thing is the energy in that space-time. More energy means more curvature. Less energy means less curvature. As John Wheeler once said, space-time tells matter how to move, and matter tells space-time how to curve. What's that have to do with elasticity, though? More than you might think. We'll set this thing aside and come back to it later. Milton's been bugging me for a job lately anyway. He can hold on to it for us. Space aliens. Can't take them anywhere. Anyway, let's talk about elasticity for a minute. We'll start with the easiest example, a spring. The tension in a spring is just a constant times how much it's stretched. We call that constant the spring stiffness, because the bigger it is, the more force it takes to stretch the spring. The stiffer the spring, the less elastic it is, so that constant tells us about its elasticity, which is exactly what we're interested in. This relationship is Hooke's law. The force is what we'd call an external cause. For example, our spring has a weight hanging on it that causes it to stretch. The stretch itself is what we'd call an internal response. We're all familiar with how things respond externally. Newton's second law says they accelerate, but things also respond internally. The ball compresses because the back of it accelerates before the front does. Other causes can even make objects change shape. An external cause will always result in some kind of internal response. Generally, we write that like this, which is still called Hooke's law, because that's not confusing. The response is proportional to the cause. The point is, we have a general rule for elasticity, one that applies to more than just springs. The formal names for these two measurements are stress and strain, but I like cause and response better. They're less jargony. Just like with springs, this constant measures how rigid the material is. It's the rigidity. Isn't that the opposite of what we want? I suppose you're right. Let's take that constant and put it on the other side. That way, the equation takes us from the cause to the response, as it should be. We'll call 1 over rigidity the elasticity, just to make our lives easier. I feel like I've seen a relationship like this before. Right, Einstein's equation. Earlier, we saw that space-time curvature is proportional to energy. In fact, that energy is the reason space-time curves, which makes it the cause, and the curvature is the response. It's the same equation. That means if space-time were some kind of material, this constant would be its elasticity. And we happen to know what that constant is. It's on the order of 10 to the minus 43. That's 43 places after the decimal point, which is very little elasticity. Space-time is super rigid, and that definitely makes sense. It takes the mass of something like a planet or moon to even notice gravity. It's the weakest of the fundamental forces because space-time is so rigid. Where did that constant come from, though? What do you mean? I just plug stuff in.
I mean, why is it that number?
Oh, because it has to be consistent with Newtonian gravity. Every new model we come up with has to be consistent with older time-tested models. Say we've got two rocks floating in space. Each one of them has a mass. Maybe one of them is bigger than the other, it doesn't matter. Newton says they each experience a force related to both of their masses and the distance between them. Which is great and all, but forces aren't actually that useful for deeper understanding. I mean, they make intuitive sense to us. It's just we found that writing laws in terms of energy instead makes them look less ugly. To the timeline. Newton's law of gravity was developed in the 1660s, but in 1813, Simeon Poisson, Semillon poisson. 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 Semillon poisson came up with an equation we now call Poisson's equation, which transforms Newton's force law into an energy law. Granted, it wasn't called energy back then, but that's what it was, whether it was called that or not. Basically, this says a change in energy across space is caused by a mass.
Actually, that's not energy. That's energy per unit mass or potential. Also, that's not mass. It's mass density.
It doesn't matter if we're only looking at this conceptually. This is energy adjacent, and this is mass adjacent. It's close enough.
Ay, ay, ay.
If we map out those energy values across space near something like the Earth, it looks like this. It's a bunch of negative numbers. The Earth is creating something we call a gravitational well. But if we're going to call it a well, we might as well imagine it as one. Did you catch that? We might as well? Because it's a gravitational well? Such a dork. Let's imagine that each of these numbers represents the depth of the well at that location. In that case, we'd have something that looks like this, which should look familiar. It's that one graphic you usually see when someone's talking about curved spacetime. Except I just made it without using Einstein's equation. It's made using Poisson's equation, an equation based on Newtonian gravity.
Bubbles bursted!
To be fair though, that gravitational well does look kinda like a fabric. Almost like Poisson's equation is only one step away from Einstein's. In fact, Einstein's equation is also an energy equation. Every term in here is also energy adjacent. So under the right conditions, it should simplify to Poisson's equation. And that's exactly what happens. We call it the weak field limit, in which we make two assumptions. One, the cause of the curvature is an object made of matter, and the particles in that object are moving slow compared to light. Two, the curvature is very close to zero. It's pretty much just the space-time from special relativity, plus a smidge of curvature. Just a smidge, though. Both of these assumptions are perfectly reasonable around something like the Earth, where we'd expect Newton's law of gravity to apply. In the weak field limit, Einstein's equation looks like this, which is only a constant factor away from Poisson's equation. It's the same equation, at least in the weak field limit. Of course, the fabric analogy is just that, an analogy, and all analogies have problems. For one, real-life materials don't always have a proportional response. If you stretch them too much, they can permanently deform or even break. Space-time's response is always proportional. That might make you think that space-time is simpler, but it's just complicated in other ways. For example, I've been displaying it as a two-dimensional surface, because that's easy. But that's a terribly inaccurate visual. Space-time isn't two-dimensional, it's four-dimensional. Both the cause and the response are represented by four-dimensional tensors, each with 10 unique components. The weak field limit only uses one of them. Most of the gravity humans experience on Earth isn't even space curvature, it's time curvature. So how elastic is the fabric of the universe? Not very elastic at all, actually. It's on the order of 10 to the minus 43. It takes a ridiculous amount of matter or light in one place to even notice gravity. Space-time might not actually be a fabric, but whatever it is, it's pretty rigid stuff. So, how many of your bubbles did I burst today? Please share in the comments. Thanks for liking and sharing this video. A special thanks goes out to Nikolaos Vasiloglou.
Vasiloglou? Vasiloglou?
For being one of our new orderlies on Patreon. If you can help out, even $1 a month on Patreon gets you access to our monthly live Q&A. YouTube channel members have access too. Don't forget to subscribe if you'd like to keep up with us. And until next time, remember, it's okay to be a little crazy. To everyone complaining about how I ignored air resistance in my Earth tunnel, of course I did. Do you think I'd go through the trouble of drilling a hole all the way through the Earth and then not evacuate the air? Come on, crazies. Anyway, thanks for watching.